Okay, let us go ahead and get ourselves started with our final session of CE220B. Today the idea is to basically have you guys to share your projects. And again, just for anyone who's watching remotely, I'll remind you all that it's all about really just sharing your work in progress and the big ideas behind things. It's A-okay if some of the concepts aren't fully realized yet. That's kind of what we want to see, is sort of just, you know, what your big ideas were, how you sort of implemented them, and hear about, you know, some of the things that worked well and some of the things where you ran into different issues. Because the idea is that when we share the problems and the challenges, they're familiar. Everyone sort of has those things, and we might be able to share some advice. So as you go through and do this, please keep it really interactive. And if you have a question, don't hold it to the end. Just ask it. And as you see people, just engage in a conversation, because it's really much more interesting as a conversation than as kind of a linear presentation. So you'll get annoyed with me asking questions, but everyone else kind of jump in too. When you see something that's familiar or similar, and ooh, how did you do that? Please jump in and ask. So we're gonna start with Christine. So Christine, please go ahead and take it away.
Well, don't ask too many questions, guys. okay, so my project was building a shared office space in Austin, Texas. And I'm just gonna go over first why Texas, why offices, and why shared spaces. That's more or less the overview. Okay, welcome to Austin. I've never been to Austin. I figured that I would use this project to give me an excuse to go to Austin. Right now would be the perfect time because it's South by Southwest, but instead.
What do you guys know of Austin? Have you been there? Henry has. What do you know about Austin?
Not a lot. I know it's a little liberal and nice, good parties.
Yeah. I was gonna say, is it
good? The weather is good.
You don't know a lot because you don't remember.
it could be that.
No. Actually, I visited for I applied there for grad school. So I visited for a day.
It's a really cool environment. I would say just hipster is probably one of the better. It's kind of Texas hipster is like compared to a lot of Texas, which is not so hipster. It's this real. It's kind of like if you took Berkeley and put it in Texas, you'd end up with Austin.
That's pretty
if
cool.
If that makes any sense. But it's definitely a cool place. You can imagine folks like you going to work down there and doing sort of really innovative Silicon Valley things, but in a non-Silicon Valley environment.
That's pretty much why I chose Texas, because Palo Alto is kind of boring. And half of last year, I mean, come on. Half of last year, I was in this shared office space, like one of these incubator hub type places in the city, and it wasn't great at all. Like, I had a terrible user experience. It just felt like going to a cafe where you have to sit and hold your pee for like 5 hours, or you have to lose your seat. It's like one or the other. So I was trying to address this.
That doesn't sound good. Okay.
I mean, I think we've all been there. Anyways, Texas, Austin, I hear it's quite lovely. It's also known as the purple sunset country. They have beautiful sunsets. The weather's pretty up there. Based on the weather patterns, it looks a lot like Palo Alto, maybe a little colder during the wintertime.
Very similar.
Yeah, pretty similar. Also, the humidity is pretty good.
I think we may be drier here.
In Palo Alto, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, compared to this. But still pretty nice.
Yeah. I'd move there.
Come on.
Oh.
And based on the wind roses, there's a lot of wind from the south. So thinking about the design, I was thinking it would be nice to capture that somehow. So to have larger, like a bigger surface area on the southern facade would be pretty cool. Formulating all this. I got this later after we did the HVAC analysis. But basically, heating isn't that much of an issue is what I got from this. But cooling is an issue. Not surprising. So I actually picked a site. I went on Google Maps. I spent about like 3 hours picking the perfect site. And it's this empty lot right next to the Facebook headquarters. I figured this is like the, you know, the tech hub downtown, kind of close to 6th Street. So it's a half block site. I think the dimensions were like 300 by 200 feet, pretty big. And it's, this is true north, so you can see it's kind of tilted. And the design is inspired by courtyard houses. I really enjoyed studying courtyard houses when I was in China. They have a very cozy feel, very communal. And when it comes to shared office spaces, you're thinking about public, semi-private, and then private spaces and how they all mix together. And I thought courtyards would be a great way of doing that mixing. Okay, so onto the design. This is, I wish I put dimensions up here, but it's pretty big. Like the top blue part is the public office space. It's an open layout. I probably should have had a legend. But this is like, I don't know, like 300 feet by 150 or something like that. It's
kind of a football field.
Yeah, it's 8,000 square feet.
Okay.
And this is just very open layout. These are, they're like partitions, half walls, where people can just use these smaller spaces within a larger open space to have, you know, some sort of ad hoc office type, or you can use them as whiteboards. So these partitions were put in there to make the space smaller. The orange is bathroom space and equipment space. Blue, like I said, is public. This is a workshop for those people who work not with computers but with their hands. So I figured, like, you know, 3D printing and that type of space over here. Red is private space. So say you are a company and you're kind of in stealth mode and you want, you know, an enclosed area, you can rent this space out. Is the thought, and this is for, these are conference spaces, and this is an office for the actual property owner. And this is a cafe for those who do want to, you know, not go to the bathroom for 5 hours and actually work in a cafe space. So this is the program of the first floor. And then I added a second floor. Oh, no, talking about landscape. And then there's going to be a healthy dose of hardscape and landscape in the middle. I haven't had time yet to quite think about what it's going to look like, but more or less this grid pattern I think is good for,
okay.
You know.
Makes perfect sense, since the courtyard is such a, you know, dominant feature. Yeah, how you landscape that will make a very big difference for how good it feels.
Yeah. Moving forward, I'm thinking about, you know, since Austin is really nice, to have outdoor spaces turn into offices. So, you know, if you guys have any ideas, I'll happily take them.
I can already picture folding walls that roll back and, you know, in our garage doors that roll up.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I was thinking of full-on garage doors. The program of the second floor, it's mainly public space. So, again, there's a lot of public space in this area. This is a conference room, a mat pod, which I'll talk about later, and a gym. And anyone can access these, is the thought. Privacy, I was thinking about privacy as an issue, even though Austin is the safest city in this country right now, which is why the entrances on the first floor are so narrow, and there's a stairway almost blocking it, so it's open but not quite.
Communal. It's like if you're part of this community, it's a very nice experience.
Yes, it's like a working
sort of
co-op.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
I rotated this so to maximize, to get some shading into the courtyard, but also since this is the south side and you do get that nice wind and you do get some sun during the afternoon, it would be an interesting also inspired by the architect from Singapore
yeah.
that we talked about. And then this is the hardscape landscape. It's all green because I haven't thought about what's going to be hardscape or what's going to be landscape, but these are all areas that are accessible. Okay, moving to the architectural design. Just some really, really quick snapshots of what this kind of looks like. This is looking from the southern end, so this is the gym, the nap pod, and the cafe. Oh yeah, and these are sloped to look at solar potential in case PVs were of an interest. Yep, there we go. Okay, so back to the program and how I was thinking about actually building this out. So I personally don't think of working as a 9-to-5 job anymore, and I think most of us can agree with that, especially since we're all students. But moving forward, you know, if you look at the Facebooks, if you look at the Googles, you work out there, you sleep there, you eat there, you do whatever there. And I think that a full package should be offered to those, not just at Google, which is why I was thinking about all these other functions. So, you know, you can work on this side, you can sleep on this side, you can take a bath over here. There's a shower, a locker room, you know, and you can like work out over here. So it's this nice little mix of spaces that you have in one area.
Fantastic. I can picture never leaving here.
Yeah, that's the whole plan.
Most people here would appreciate the idea of why we need nap pods.
Yeah, I agree. I was thinking hammocks. Okay, so the structural design. I couldn't quite take totally forgot to take a snapshot or a rendering of the structure. But
tell us about those interesting grids. That's funny.
Yeah. So I decided to use concrete for one. It reminds me of the materials actually used in China. But the grids, this is like a nightmare. Yeah, so as you can see, the second floor is tilted. So we have grids going this way, grids going this way, grids going this way, grids going this way. And at first, Alana and Glenn and Anga gave me the great idea of you should have them align whenever possible. And I realized that was going to be really hard. I spent a lot of days trying to do this, and then I was thinking, well, the second floor is pretty much, it's like, they're like shipping crates, kind of, right, on top. So instead of trying to make everything work, I didn't. Basically, this just has a grid pretty much independent of the bottom.
Sure.
And
let's talk about it. Yeah, in a way, that's actually sort of realistic. I can sort of picture these upper units just sort of being craned in and just kind of being self-contained, steel-floored units that just stack on top. I don't know, like, how's that resonate with people? Did you see that? Does that sort of...
Yeah, for prefab. Yeah.
If you sell that as a prefab, you get all the part of it.
Yeah.
I think one thing this might get people thinking about and asking about is like, ooh, what if I could have a third level? You know, where you put some more crates in. Yeah. One thing I think you've done that's really nice is even though it sort of feels to you sort of random, your second floor actually is, it's very regular, it just is rotated 40 degrees or something like that. And there's an order to that that's kind of nice. You know, so you sort of think, oh, well, third layer could be in there too. It doesn't feel all that complex. It's a picture.
The only challenging part that I found with this is that, this thing sticks out so much, and I didn't put a column down here, so I just put a bunch of reinforcement down, I guess right here. So the bottom part looks like this. Same with over here. But other than these specialty parts that are probably going to have to get made, it's rather simple.
let's just talk about your cantilevers. It's, you got a funny thing going on. Like, how far out do you estimate that cantilevers?
This one?
Yeah, but that's probably your biggest one. Yeah, how far out does that stick? 50 feet?
Maybe 40.
I don't know. It's, 40 is going to be pretty big. Can you do a 40-foot cantilever?
Maybe 30. It was big.
That's okay. Just, in general, do you think you can? Or how does that, you know, and when you hear a 40-foot cantilever, how does that make you feel? It's kind of like, it's kind of about as long as this room. Yeah, Jackie's shaking her head. So what do you think? Is it possible? Yeah, I think it's possible. Yes. Yeah. It creates a very daring space. Yeah. Now, the reason I think it may be possible here is, notice how your 40-foot cantilever on the one side is almost perfectly offset with this 30-foot cantilever on the other side. So in a way, it kind of balances each other, which, you know, kind of works to your advantage. Something like that. I think it may be, doable.
So if you're cantilevering it on both sides, actually, there is a column somewhere over here. Does that, okay, so it should be fine.
One side offsets the other. Usually I have the cantilevers all the way just out here and just start sagging down here and it's a big, load on my elbow. If it's sort of on both sides, it's like a tray that's being balanced where as long as it's sort of even weight on both sides, as long as the beams that support it, you kind of take it, it sort of just balances.
Yeah.
And so it's actually not too bad.
Cool.
Yes, Henry. Yeah.
What if you have like a party on the top, but no party on
the then you have the load on one side. Although, we got to think about the live load versus the dead loads. You know, it'll sort of offset it somewhat. Although, this is how buildings get in trouble, is that the parade comes through and everyone goes to the balcony on one side of the building and you get this really unusual loading case. So we have to think about that. You're right.
Okay. Well, this is the structural part.
Yeah, but I can totally picture the thing, two pieces that are sort of like prefabricated and like kind of dropped on each other. Mm-hmm. You know, it just creates sort of a very interesting architecture. Being under those cantilevers, I think it's really cool.
So I see that maybe you can have like some sort of structured wall. I don't know if it interferes with the courtyard, but if it can turn somehow into it's a structured wall, but can also form an architectural feature in the courtyard.
Mm-hmm.
It's not
below the cantilever? Yeah.
I think when you really start doing your landscaping design, you might figure out there's an opportunity to sort of subdivide that into this big courtyard. Have some things that come down that really do feel like architectural features.
Yeah, I'm not sure what they might be. Like there would be a waterfall, I don't know.
It's not what you're thinking. I think you're looking at it, you're nodding your head. What are you thinking?
Well, like you were saying about the cantilevers on both sides, like, could see like a pier sticking out of the middle, maybe like a cool design, kind of like a bridge, where you have like a pier sticking out, and kind of like Henry was saying, castle adds on the architectural side. So then that would be what's holding the two cantilevers in place.
Lots of possibilities on this one. So
thanks for the advice.
I'm afraid of it. I think you just go further. You kind of like find some very cool things you can do with all that overhead.
Okay. HVAC is pretty straightforward, although there's a lot of stuff in here. It's because it's the size of a football field. It's like 8,000 square feet. I tried to keep it as simple as possible. There was a nice mechanical space that I didn't even intend for HVAC, but I ended up using the HVAC over here. Yellow's fresh air supply.
In some ways, that's, although there's a lot of pieces of it, it's sort of beautifully simple. It's really nice. There's not a whole lot of snaking around. Just, you have these main spines and everything comes off. Which is great when you sort of get that. It'll be sort of a very efficient system, a very easy to build system.
Yeah. And it's the supply and the return are offset by foot. So there's no need to, play this game. Okay. Plumbing was also pretty straightforward. I decided to model these two bathrooms. Let's see.
You got a lounge in there.
Yeah, okay, so I didn't really want to talk about the plumbing because it's super straightforward, but I did want to talk about my sofas.
okay, so tell us about your lounges.
I mean, some people like to, you know, take calls in bathrooms, I've noticed. I do that.
There's a funny thing, it's actually it's here in other parts of the world. It used to be that in older buildings, the ladies' room was huge compared to the men's room.
Yeah.
Because they would have fainting couches, where if you
I
were just...
Those,
that?
You have fainting couches? I said, you have fainting couches in Illinois? Sorry, keep going.
No, it's like in school.
Yeah.
Like in Champaign.
Yeah.
When we go, it's especially in the older buildings.
Yeah.
When you get inside, you'll see the sofa first.
Yeah.
And then you'll see all the people throwing the bags there. Then go in.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing when I first see that, and then I get used to it.
As a man, I'm like, wait, there's no justice in this.
Why
party
you
going on in there?
Don't worry, your side has one too.
You were very democratic that way.
Yes, I try.
Is this where we go to take a phone call?
Yep. So this is the best part about the bathroom. It's
we're gonna work on your sound insulation. just to make sure.
Yeah, this is an acoustic wall.
Oh, very good. Okay, that's a good call.
That's a good save.
You don't want to be on a conference call and you're flush in the back. That's just not
right. Anyways, that's it. And then I had an appendix full of schedules, which I'm not about to show you guys. But that's my project. It's been fun.
Cool.
Thank you.
It's a really neat concept. I really love the idea of the whole mission of these hipster incubator spaces that are a little bit kinder, so you don't feel like if you lose your seat and go to the restroom, you're gonna like lose your space. So,
yeah.
Okay.
Or everyone crowds around like one outlet. It just makes no sense.
So just all fighting for a place to charge your computer.
Yeah.
Okay. So I guess if you're gonna have mobile spaces and reconfigurable spaces, you actually have to make them reasonable in terms of what they provide. Because I think we've all done it at the airport where you're. You're all stalking the one fish.
Yeah. Cool. All right.
Would you like to chime in?
What?
Would you like to chime in?
Yeah. Is it my turn?
How's your project going?
Gustavo. I think Gustavo called dibs on being second.
But, okay.
Just a compliment that.
Yeah.
What if we must have a hospital? That's an invitation. That they're being like this huge cafeteria worker that I think people go and work.
Yeah.
But they decided to save money on the outlets, so there's no outlets. And there's amazing furniture for laptops and people to go and work.
But there's no outlet?
But there's no outlet.
This
doesn't make
sense. They should offer the induction chargers,
mm-hmm.
The ones at Starbucks.
That happens when you hire like a top architecture firm and
open it to
you.
No, it's amazing how that'll make a difference. Given where we live today, if the difference between a usable space and not is whether an outlet. If you put an outlet there, then I can work.
Yeah.
If there's no outlet there, then I'm always at risk.
And like the furniture is amazing, it's beautiful. There's not.
So for instance,
do you just have a hospital?
Do you think regarding outlets, it's like you know, Tesla, there's no outlets?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what the news is. I think in some circumstances, like you purposefully don't want outlets because you want many people to go in and out. Otherwise, if you come in and there's outlets and you want it.
This is an interesting issue. This is almost like it's the Starbucks issue or even the McDonald's issue where you go on in, you get like one cup of coffee, and then you basically camp out for 8 hours, which is nice for you, but not so nice for the business owners. So,
yeah.
Do people try to control that? I think they do try to control that.
Yeah, when we toured the terminals, we would like SFO, and like the construction manager was saying, design where the outlets are, you really like control where
they'll go and
camp out. So you know where they're gonna go. It's very, very cool.
So I would want if I had a restaurant or like some snack shop, I want the outlets to be right across there,
mm-hmm.
so that people would. Yeah, it is sort of an interesting issue about whether you offer them or not. And I think people do play that. But the standard has changed. You got to realize that compared in all these older buildings, people didn't carry laptops. So that wasn't an issue. Even in this building, look at all the outlets on the floor, and it's still inadequate. We're all tripping over. There's like two or three floor outlets, and it's like a gaggle of snakes down there. So, someday when we all have wireless induction charging, it won't be an issue. In the meantime, we're sort of stuck. Okay, Mr. Gustavo, tell us about the old City Hall.
All right, so today I'll be sharing my project on the renovation of an old City Hall.
Logo.
Logo? Oh, yeah. So, an overview. First, I'll share some project background on why I chose this building and the location. Second, I'll tell you about the repurpose of the building and some of the design. And lastly, I'll share some design highlights. So let's get started with the project background. The location is Woodburn, Oregon. This is where I grew up. And fairly small city, 24,000 population. And the community is composed of mainly by immigrants. There's a lot of Mexican immigrants and some Russian immigrants, and also recently Somali refugees. And there's a pretty big opportunity for downtown enhancement. So this is downtown here, and this little plaza was done probably in the last 10 years. And my building is actually located here. So now about the building, it was built in 1914. It was the city hall for the city for several years until it was deemed like unoccupiable anymore. The building original size was 12,500 square feet, and it has two levels above grade and one partially below grade. And these levels I have chosen to keep the way they are. And the construction is a exterior brick facade.
Just a comment. It's interesting. It's not that big a building. At 12,500, some people are building houses that big now, which is really kind of shameful.
Has the zoning changed? If you personally wanted to, or the owner wanted to build higher, could you build higher? Or do you think that's might be a good investment? I'm not sure.
It's actually out on the market right now. I think the idea is to try and preserve the building how it is. And so that's what I tried to do during this project, is model it how it was and make as little changes as possible to the facade. And I'll tell you a little bit about that.
Why did they deem it unoccupiable? Was it a safety thing, or what happened along the way? I'm just curious.
I think they just chose to build a new building.
Okay,
which is what
they abandoned this.
And they abandoned it.
Kind of a loss to the culture when you do that. Okay. Yeah.
So when thinking ahead and thinking about the community, I knew I wanted to provide specific spaces, such as space for youth, an event center for like weddings and quinceañeras and just large gatherings. Also space for grown-ups and some space for children, to kind of just get all these different groups coming into the space, and so a family could be here and they could all just kind of choose their spot and then leave together. So that was the idea, to really turn this old city hall into a very community-focused center. So then when I was trying to configure all these spaces, I ended up doing this is the basement's here. Okay. So that's the lower level, and that's my team center over there on the left, and then what I'm calling now the club, which is the grown-up space, and then restrooms, and then this event center, which is slightly above the basement level, which is at grade, and then the mechanical room on the outside. Then the second story, I have the cafe and food area, the preschool, and I have the restrooms. And then here, this is all open office space, the third level.
So teens and adults in like the club, comedy clubs, they're all downstairs.
Yeah.
And food, and then preschool, and then office upstairs.
Yes.
And who's up in the offices? What kind of people?
What I was envisioning was like maybe a nonprofit or an organization that has the same focus as the center does to really provide social services and
community services center. People. It's interesting.
Right.
It's kind of like what the town square used to be, only it's inside. Yeah. Henry, what do you think?
Oh.
I thought you were waving, but you went
off.
So one of the first things that I decided to focus on was on daylighting improvements. I ran several daylighting analyses, and the facade just didn't provide much natural lighting. So one of the changes that I decided to make was to add an atrium, so similar to what we have here in Y2E2. And that really helped the daylighting to get that natural lighting in the core of the building, so that improved my analysis. So here you see, on the basement, I wasn't expecting to get any lighting just because it's down there and it's hard to get lighting there, daylighting. But you can see here that the other levels get some pretty good daylighting. This is the second level, so coming through the atrium. And this is the third level, the office space, and there's quite a bit of lighting there. And this is the event center, which has a lot of windows on the south side, so that explains why the high levels of luminescence. So the structure.
Can you go back just for a second? I'm just very curious about something. Oh, even go back one. I want to see the front of your slide. Go back to that. One more. That's really cool. Is that like a picture from your retinal? Or what's that a picture of? It's a really interesting 3D representation. It's all sketchy.
Yeah, it's just from Revit, the 3D model. I just exported an image.
It's really cool the way it's got sort of the transparency of the building, but it's got the sketchy lines. It looks like some artist did that. That's really that's really cool. Okay, come on. I hadn't seen that effect.
So for the structure, I decided to use cast-in-place concrete just because it was going to be hard to get steel members in the building, and it was just easier for construction. And the beam size range from 12 by 24s and 16 by 32. Columns 12 by 18, and then the footings are 72 by 48 by 18. And here, this is kind of like a cool spot here because this is the event center, so here you have the footings higher than these because this level is above the basement. And then the columns go up from what I call level 1.5 up to level 3. And this is my mechanical system. I decided to do a VAV single duct, and I have two air handling units. One out here on the outside mechanical room, it's an indoor air handling unit, and that serves the basement. And that one was easy to model just because it just came out of that room and then straight onto the ceiling area. And I decided to use round ducts there because they're more efficient and I have exposed ceilings. So those go nice with the exposed ceilings. On level two, on that side of it, well, I'm servicing levels 2 and 3 with the rooftop air handling units. So I have my shafts coming down, and then I go down to L2, and I have a acoustic ceiling tile there, so that's why I use the rectangular ducts there because they're hidden. And then I have just the usual air terminals that we're using. And on L3, I decided to go again with the round ducts and use the exposed ceiling. So those ducts are exposed, and you'll get to see them right now in the rendering. And I still use the air terminals in the restroom because there I do have ceilings.
Mr. Henry.
Oh, sorry, quick question. You said you use the round ducts because they're more efficient. Can they have to be not exposed?
Can they still be hidden?
Yeah. It's fine.
It's a good question. They are more efficient. It's interesting. We tend to use them in exposed scenarios because they look a whole lot better. They're also a little more expensive, as best I understand, to kind of run it that way. So it's more expensive, but they are definitely more efficient.
But you can expose, you don't have to expose them.
No.
Mm. Oh, okay.
It could be hidden. It's just sort of then you're getting efficiency, but you aren't really benefiting from the aesthetics of it. But they're sort of hidden from you. But yeah, it could be a mixture of those. I like the way you have the two air handling units to service the different levels and you're kind of minimizing the shaft runs because it was opportune to have the one at the basement level.
Yeah.
You already had a space and you just go through for the other. So that worked well. I think just overall, this diagram was actually a particularly nice one. I think it gives you a pretty good sense very quickly of how it's running and make sense just right away because how the overall system's working.
So for the plumbing system, I had a strategy, and most of you guys, I hope, had the same strategy. I don't know. Do you guys, can you guys tell? Anyone? And God knows. Yeah, so when I was first meeting with Glenn and the TAs, this was suggested to stack my restroom. So it was early enough in the design where, you know, that's, I just did that right away. And it worked out nice because here, you know, they're stacked and I just copy-pasted. It was a little hard to mess around with the pipes at first, but then I got it to work. So that was the strategy, just stack restrooms.
Jacqueline, would you care to comment on that strategy?
I like the strategy.
Oh!
Yeah, it's like I have one that is stacked. I have one that is not. But for the stacked one, it's like so much easier to have copy and paste.
Yeah.
It just makes your life easier. That's all you can say.
So thank you, God, and the rest of the team. and one thing that I like to highlight are these pipes. These are the mains. And I actually decided to locate those outside of the building because I just didn't have, I didn't want to run them through the brick wall, so it just makes sense to penetrate it and then run them through the outside. A disadvantage that I can see is the thermal losses, but at the same time you have a cold water line going, so kind of neutralizes. Plus if you add insulation, I don't think the losses will be that great.
The big thing is you'd want to put some pipe insulation on them. But you think about trying to box them in somehow minimize the way they look.
Yeah. And so these fall down to that mechanical room on that. So you see the mechanical room there. Mm-hmm. So they go down there. And another idea that I had was maybe like making it look like they were rainwater leads. So if they look like, you know, gutter system, but they're really domestic water. And this is the drain, the sanitary line.
Sure. Mm-hmm. And so everything comes down as this one main, riser that comes out. Yeah. Excellent.
And for the energy analysis, I implemented several energy efficiency measures, mainly the floor insulation and adding insulation to windows or making them more energy efficient, mm-hmm. and also the natural lighting that I talked to you guys about previously. When I first ran this analysis, I was at 70 kBTU per square foot per year. And the big ones that I kind of decided to address was the floor insulation and then the windows. And so I ended at 56 kBTU per square foot per year.
Huge improvement. You still, as I look at the graph, it's always funny because it's,
the scale's a little off.
Yeah, if we still have a lot of Windows Solar, what can we do to kind of continue to improve on the whole Windows Solar issue? Because we have that historic shape, so it's hard to add the shades on the outsides that way. What can we do to continue to improve that one? Cool inside. Can we do anything to the glass properties or any sort of films or Henry, what do you think?
You reduce the SHGC.
I don't remember if it's reduce or increase. It's, you play with that number.
Reduce.
Okay, it says the heat gain coefficient, so reducing it. So what's that?
We put in blinds on the inside.
It's weird that we even just like roller blinds or just some sort of blinds. Just even better if we have them on little sensor controls or something like that. So we'll just block that sun out before it's too good.
Yeah.
It's definitely tricky working with historical buildings. Actually, for the walls are all brick and stuff like that, right?
Yep.
Did you end up sort of changing that layering at all? Did you put any insulation inside there? Or?
I did because I decided to use the brick wall that kind of comes with Revit, so that already added insulation.
Okay, so there's a layer of some.
So I kind of did add it, but it was part of that one wall.
Are you going to replace the windows or just kind of trying to, improve the values on the existing ones?
Probably just improve, because I don't think they need to be replaced.
Okay.
But for this analysis, I said, if I get the equivalent R value of a double pane window, will that result? And other areas that I would tackle next would be light fixtures, just using daylighting controls. That would help me reduce the heating load from those.
Mm-hmm.
And also using smart strips for the miscellaneous equipment. So those are these two larger areas.
Just to kind of really cut it's amazing how, you know, overall your building is so efficient that the equipment and the lighting fixture loads are really some of the bigger generators that heat. Yeah, more so than the people. That's interesting.
So now, these are the design highlights. This was the club. I didn't really like the name at first that Glenn brought up, but then after a while I was like, oh, it's a pretty cool name, so I'll keep
stuck.
It. So yeah, so there's a guy preparing to put on a show, and decided to go with the blue walls because that's the high school colors. It's royal blue. And so there you see the ducts coming in, and then you also see the light fixtures. And yeah, you got rows of chairs, and then you have some higher tables in the back. And then the next spot, my personal favorite, is the teen spot. No longer a teenager, but you know, this would be the ideal place to hang out. And this is actually beneath the entrance stairs. So the stairs come down this way.
Yeah.
So this is back in that hole.
Tucked in there?
Yeah.
Is that like the high school logo for the mascot or
no,
that?
Those are the Portland Timbers. So in Oregon, that's their soccer team, and they won the MLS Cup, and it's a big deal. So I decided to put the logo there in the wall.
That's a TV that's reflecting? That's what's
yeah,
it's reflecting.
TV.
Actually,
yes.
So I just noticed the logo on the bottom right, is that like a 180 flip to thing behind the T, or not really?
He thinks that your corporate logo looks like the Portland.
Oh no!
Or just a coincidence? It's a rotated 180, or has nothing to do with
it. It doesn't, but that's a good, good observation.
Oh okay.
That's
handy. Nice use of decals. Is that like a green wall on the side there?
Yeah, it's like a turf wall.
Ah.
Just because it's soccer. So, yeah.
Oh, very good. Yeah. Nice. I think it's nice you're taking, these are small spaces, but you're articulating them in a way that actually makes them feel really cool. Like even the club was really nice in that. You know, the use of the blue walls and all that stuff, it's not only kind of a good local color, it sort of makes the space a little ambiguous about where the stage is. That Mr. Comedian guy, he looked pretty good standing up there against the blue wall because you couldn't see like a big white wall right behind him. It's, you know, gives you this ambiguous illusion of more space, which again,
and so the other spot is the office. So there's the boss hanging out there, and you see the structural columns. And I decided to put this brick wall here to hide the shaft, just to give it that feel of like old historic. And then this is the atrium. And then here since the L2 has acoustic ceiling tile, I use soffits here to kind of hide all the ducts and stuff. And I painted my ducts white so that they kind of hid and also reflected light.
It's kind of a nice mix of old and new. You kind of, it's cool to still, even though you're in a new inside, still feel the quality of the older building.
Yeah. And lastly, this guy standing on the roof, looking at his phone, maybe checking the forecast. Well, there's
he should be going
phone.
Inside.
Decided to do this because that's kind of how I felt this week, you know, just trying to finish up, but the storm's coming behind me, but, you know, it's done now. So with that, I'd like to close and take any questions or comments.
I'm very impressed with what you were able to, you know, kind of accomplish in that older space. It was like fighting constraints every step of the way.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
Squeeze it in there. It's a difficult problem. But yeah, I don't know, I think through simplicity, you kind of, you know, found a sweet spot where you got what you needed to get accomplished, but it didn't get fussy.
Yeah, it was challenging at times because I thought I had more space than I actually did. And then when Glenn was telling me to like scale, and Alana brought this up several times, like it looks good on paper, but in reality, how big is that room? Or how big is that space? So that made it challenging.
So for the building, did you get the drawings and use the as-built?
I just used Google Earth and kind of got the footprint, and then I used Street View to look at where the windows were and at what heights, and then I just did the Revit model based on that.
Those are PVs?
Yeah, they're PVs.
Great job. Thank you for sharing that. very inspired. I like the idea of going back into older buildings and bringing new life into communities that are just kind of neglected. Because actually, what you didn't say, it's kind of, I feel for the story of the whole town. You know, it's out by the highway, they built the new strip mall, and so much of the commercial center moves out there, and then it leaves the old downtown kind of abandoned. And yeah, that happens in a lot of towns right now. It moves to the highway, and the town square just sort of gets neglected.
Yeah, I didn't share that, but kind of like a couple miles away, there's I-5 runs through the city, and they have like a big outlet mall and more commercial development, and so that's where all the outsiders go, but
yeah,
the people from the city still use downtown.
They need a place, and they're not necessarily hipsters are going to hang out in Starbucks.
Yeah.
They still need their own place to go, as a family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So very cool response to sort of the social environment you're trying to create.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Who is volunteering next? Is it Jeff?
Or Brittany?
Either way. Oh, you get an arm wrestler. Constraint where they have to leave right at 3:20. Everyone's really good. I don't want to rush it towards the end. There's never enough time for them to say everything you want to say. Come eat some cookies. I'm not taking these home. I haven't got to eat them. So.
Yep.
All for Brittany. You're wondering, right?
Yeah, can I just connect one of
this
those?
Thing. This
oh,
thing.
Okay. That's the port.
Yes.
Okay.
And are you in PowerPoint again?
Yes.
Come on, man. And where are you?
You
see this? Folder or
Ulysses? Yes. Oh, not that
one.
Yeah.
Odd. Okay, you are ready.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sing Chai. I'm going to present you my class project, which revolves mostly around the original idea of the original assignment on sustainable built environment living lab and exhibition center at Jasper Ridge Biological Preserve adjacent to Stanford's campus. So I'll dive into architectural system and then structural system, HVAC system, plumbing system, and finally some renderings and sustainable features. So I kicked off this class project by finding some inspirations online. So one of them was the California Academy of Sciences in San Francisco. I was very intrigued by the green dome at the center at the exhibition center because it provides cooling effect by absorbing heat surrounding. And then next, I was also inspired by the leaf-like structure called Henderson Center in Hong Kong. I wanted to build a building with exemplified sustainable designs. For instance, building a water pool to collect rainwater drained from the roof of the leaf-like building. I also wanted to put a lot of photovoltaic cells at the top of the roof. And finally, I wanted to add some aesthetic features to my project site by incorporating the irregular surfaces similar to those in Walt Disney Concert Hall in Los Angeles. So this is my rough sketch. Basically, I have exhibition center at the left corner, and then educational space seminar room at the right, and top I'll have offices. And as you can see, I'm trying to mimic some of the features like the green dome in the exhibition building, and also the water pool to collect rainwater besides the deflect building. And before I started creating all those walls, roofs, I actually did some building studies. One of them is wind study at Jasper Ridge Biological Preserve. So I found that the highest annual wind frequency distribution is found between south and southeast directions. So there's where I'm going to put my wind turbine at that vicinity to harness the wind energy. And then at the same time, I also try to put the building as close to the Shearsville Lake as near as possible so that it can provide some cooling effects to the building. And for solar study wise, I did some study inside Revit, and I played with some different timings and different dates. And it seems that the southwest side of the building experiences the highest sunlight intensity during winter and summer. So I wanted to do an inclined plane to put some photovoltaic cells to maximize the solar radiation gain. And at the same time, I'm also aware that I have to be careful with some shading features at the southwest side of the building so that not much sunlight can go through the building. So this is my conceptual masses. And then the part that I have difficulties with is obviously the roof top of the leaf-like structures. So basically, I need to form two lines with a lot of connecting points and then to form a curved surface on top of it. The rest is pretty much cubical and rectangular, so it's quite easy. So so after the conceptual messes, I actually started building my system. I put all the walls, roofs, and I thought I'm quite done with the design without realizing that it's good to do daylighting analysis. So when I did daylighting analysis, I actually changed a lot of features in the building, which was quite good because it kind of add aesthetic value to my building. And this is my first floor of my exhibition building. As you can see, the sunlight is quite evenly distributed around the building, except these four compartments. This is because of the walkway that I have at the second floor, which tries to prevent the sunlight from penetrating to the first floor. But then it's quite okay because these four compartments are actually the restrooms, these two. And then this is the storage room and mechanical room.
Very good.
So
they're not regularly occupied.
Yes.
And
yeah, so I think it's quite fine. And then this is the second floor, which is quite okay.
That's amazingly even for everyone who's been playing with solar daylighting. That's hard to get that much evenness.
Yeah. And same goes to third floor and also the leaf-like building structure. So, but unfortunately, I only passed the first standard category for LEEDS requirement. So 88% at 9 a.m. and 93% at 3 p.m.
You have to get like 2% more to get
yes.
the second point?
Yeah,
oh.
I try a lot of things, but apparently I just stay there. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to give up.
Oh, there's a creative challenge for us here. Have
yeah.
to get 2% more.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Okay, so as you can see from here, this is what I have from my conceptual masses. And after playing around with the daylighting analysis, it actually greatly transformed the building, especially on the rooftop. I have a couple of skylights to allow the penetration of sunlight from the top, and also some special roof, curved dome-shaped roofs. So moving on to the overall building system, this is kind of the overall view from the cloud renderings. So basically, I have a courtyard connecting different buildings with different functionalities. So this will be the main exhibition building, and then the leaf-like building for seminar and educational spaces. And then this irregular surfaces building is for for conferences. And then finally, this building is for offices. So this site is actually it's kind of enclosed because I think it's meant for private spaces so that people can pay undivided attention to the seminars or conference. And also I would like to mention that the wind turbine is facing the southeast side to harness the wind energy. And so for my project, I mostly use concrete floors and walls for great thermal mass. And I'd like to share with you the structure for my green roof. So basically, I have 8 layers between the top and the bottom of the green roofs. So first 2 layers, I have plant and earth, and then I have fabric to separate the dirts and the gravels. And the gravels, I think, is for drainage. And then I have some rigid insulation to improve the resistance, thermal resistance and thermal mass. And then after that, damproofing is just to prevent the water from entering the concrete below it. So next I'm going to brief you guys about the each floor of each building site. So first I'll go from the cafeteria at the basement and then to exhibition building, big light building, conference room and offices. So these are my cafeterias facing opposite side by side. People can get access to it by either taking the circular elevator from the third or second floor to the basement, or you can take staircases at the opposite side to go down to the basement to go to the cafeteria. And I wanted to put cafeteria beneath the level so that people from surrounding the area can actually go down during lunch or dinner. And then, so this is my first floor of the exhibition building. At the center, you can see here's a rainforest exhibit. And then the red boxes are actually the egress and staircases for people to access from top to bottom levels. Then this is the second floor and the third floor. So from the third floor, you can actually see the artistic features of the rooftop, so like green roof and skylights and other stuff. And also I have some breezeway around here for shading purposes. You'll see it at the end of presentation, so it's like kind of a rendering. And then for my leaf-like building, these red boxes again are the egress for people to exit. And then this is the play zone, and these two are the educational space and seminar rooms. So one interesting feature about this building is that I have no ceiling and a glass roof so that people can actually view the trusses from the bottom to top. I'm going to show you the trusses in a couple of minutes. And then this is my conference building and my offices. So for this assignment, I'm particularly focusing on two main buildings, which are the exhibition building and also the leaf-like building. And these are some of the renderings from Cloud. This is the entrance to the exhibition building. And this is another view from the courtyard, stand of the courtyard, one in the evening and one during the day.
Wow.
Yep.
I was going to take it all in for a bit. Can you
right.
Go back again? That was
it. Could you go back again?
Yeah, just to the.
Oops, too much. Okay. So this is another view from the courtyard. And
yeah.
This is actually the basement. So these two
between
are the
cafeterias.
Yeah. And then some picnic tables. And then people can just walk around and hang around. Oh, and also these are rain roofs actually. You can see how thick they are.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so on top of the cafeteria.
Yep.
Okay, yeah.
So next I'm going to talk about structural system. So this is my overall structural systems, but I'm going to focus on two, the structural systems for exhibition building and leaf-like structure. So for my main exhibition building, it's quite straightforward except for these two portions. So the left image shows a portion at the south side of the building, which is like a sloped roof. So you kind of need to create an inclined plane in Revit to place the beam and beam systems. And then for the image on the right, for the circular openings, basically I just put different beam systems to make it a circle. And also, as you can notice, the top portion of this structural system is actually in lighter color because this is the portion that I took for structural analysis in robots that I'm going to show later on. So for my leaf-like building wise, it takes a lot of effort, but it's really nice to see the output. So one of the challenges that I face is to create these trusses. So normally there's no problem if you attach the trusses to the roof.
Yeah.
But in my case, because of the irregular surface of the roof, it's actually a wall.
Yeah.
So I actually kind of need to manipulate the whole flat truss to a bowstring truss. So I actually edit each curvature manually for each of these trusses one by one to get the curvatures.
So did you cut a series of sections through,
yes,
so you could draw them all?
Right.
Okay.
So basically just move the sections to one of each sections.
Very good.
And
good.
Then at the top cord of the trusses, I have purlins that you suggest to me.
Mm-hmm.
Basically connect them to each other. I think it's good to provide strength since the green roofs are so heavy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, and so I forgot to mention that I actually use steel for most of my structural elements to provide mechanical strength. And for leaf-like building, I incorporate some of the woods, you can see from these yellow color elements, just for aesthetic values. Okay, and this is the structural analysis that I mentioned before, and the portion that I took from the image that I showed you. So I actually did this structural analysis for dead locates, and as you can see in the comparison, from the original material to the updated material, my original materials are actually kind of oversized. So these are oversized. So if I have time, I would like to play with this and maybe make my structural elements more precise. Okay, so going to my HVAC system. Yeah, so this is kind of the 3D HVAC system for my exhibition building. And for exhibition building, I actually have two rooftop air handler units. Actually, before HVAC system, I only have one mechanical room here.
Uh-huh.
So I found that if I connect all these pipes together and link them to this air handler unit, the ducts are going to be so big,
yeah,
that it's going to be so impossible. So I built another mechanical room on the other side.
Very good.
Yeah, so one handles the left and then one handles the right.
That's probably just a very sensible way too. You're on the other side of an atrium. Probably the loads will be a little bit different for the two of them. So
right.
I think we often get into segmenting. I think a lot of us sort of hit that where we found out that one just wasn't going to make it.
Mm-hmm.
So
yep.
Makes sense to slow down.
Yep. So these are the floor plans for my HVAC systems. So for all the spaces, exhibition spaces, I tried to put as many air terminals as I could to evenly distribute the air. So yeah, it kind of gets big when it comes to the mechanical room. But they are still within the mechanical room, so it's fine. And then for my leaf-like building, I have an underground air handler unit at the back of the leaf-like structure so that people wouldn't be able to see such a complicated structure. And this is a floor plan for the HVAC system. And one of the strategies that I use to minimize the clashes is to define different heights for different systems. So as you can see, I define my floor as 15 feet and then ceiling at 10 feet. So for HVAC system wise, I define them as 13 feet 6 inches and 11 feet 4 inches respectively, so that they actually have 2 feet each for the pipings. Yeah. And then yeah, I try to do an interference check in Revit between the ducts and ducts,
yeah,
and there's no interference.
Uh-huh.
So that's a good use. And then besides the ventilation system, I also have the radiant floor heating system to heat up the building when it's necessary. So these are the floor plans for the floor heating system. It's actually not that bad, except for these openings that you need to look at in another ways. And then as usual, they are looked to the mechanical rooms. And then this is for leaf-like buildings. I actually wanted to connect these pipes to a ground heat source pump,
mm-hmm,
but I'm not really sure how to do it. But if I have more time, I would like to work on that.
Oh, no,
so just to make it more complete.
Perfect sense,
yeah,
as a way to go ahead and feed those. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Okay. So moving on to plumbing system. So this is my 3D piping systems. And I have domestic hot water and cold water for washing basins. And then I also have gray water systems inside my building just to recycle water. And then this is cross-section of the building to show you the pipings. And as you can see, the sanitary pipes are actually inclined at a certain angle, but it fits within the thickness of the floor, which is okay. And also, all these black vertical pipes are actually the sprinkler from the sprinkler systems. And these are the sprinkler systems for the building. And I actually use auto-routing, either network or perimeter system, mm-hmm. because I think they are the best to suit the spaces mm-hmm. in my building. But I think Revit is not smart enough to route some of the pipes for the openings. So I actually need to delete some of the pipes that they auto-route for me. Mm-hmm. And then I create to suit the openings. Yeah.
I think that's a perfectly valid way to work with it. Let it do a lot of the work and then go through and kind of clean up little things mm-hmm. that, you know, with your intelligence, you know, don't make the most sense.
Right. And also for the pipe that I use, I actually make them at 10 feet 2 inches so that there won't be any clashes between this and all other systems. So these are some of my renderings and sustainable features. This is the green roof near to the basement. And then this is a view from the third floor of the exhibition building. You can see the wind turbine here, and then this rooftop, green roof, and the bristole for shading purposes. And then this is a view for overhangs and light shelves at the south side of the exhibition building. This is the overhang, and then these are the light shelves that I use. And this is the rainwater pool that I say, which is meant to collect rainwater from the roof. And these are some of the interior renderings. So this is the entrance to the main exhibition building.
It's Christmas.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, this is the rainforest dome behind it.
Very good.
Yep. And this is the view at night. So I actually put some floor lights,
yeah.
Is that how you call it?
Yeah.
I don't know how to call it.
Floor
just
lights, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a real level. That's actually quite nice.
Yeah.
Super. That's looks amazing. Wow.
And then this is during the day. These are the fountains. I'm not sure whether you can see it. But the water is actually below the floor level. So it's beneath it. And then this is the office. And that's all for my presentation.
Fantastic. Wow. Thank you.
Thank you.
Questions? Comments? It's amazing how much you took on and the level of detail you carried out of it, all out, too.
Yeah.
Because you really thought of each of the different buildings. And you really have four different buildings in there. Very, very well. So it's just fantastic. It looks like a sort of a very exciting structure. It has kind of a nice feel to it. There's some things ultimately what we can play around with in terms of the site. I know where the pad ends, you have these very tall kind of site walls. It's really just the earth, and there's some things we can do with terracing the landscaping and putting in some landscape in there. But yeah, the building itself is like a fantastic.
Yeah.
Just have
a good design.
Ms. Brittany, are you ready to come out and join us? Do you not want to follow them?
So pop yourself in over here. We can send it over. Is it all PowerPoint?
Yeah.
Okay, let's send over the slide. What do we get? Too much junk. It's kind of nice. Yeah.
How many people?
Me?
How many people?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
A Actually, still three of you.
Three. I'll try to keep it quick.
Oh, nice. That's okay. Wildlife Center. Sounds good.
Alright, so as you may or may not know, I did a wildlife rehabilitation center with a community center. Jump right in. This is the community center. For kind of like a quick overview, I wanted to have a more organic design for this portion with a central atrium. So,
if you want to turn on the slideshow, it will make a little bit easier.
Oh, great. There we go. So, the main entrance is here, and this is an atrium with a glass roof. There's a cafe with outdoor seating, and a community room and conference room that have walls that can move, so it's a little more versatile. Okay, and then this portion is where the animals will be for the education. The circular room is the education room, and then off to either side are enclosures where education animals can live. There's an employee like circulation around the outside and like visitor circulation here. And I blocked it off from the atrium because this section is not conditioned. These are open to the air.
So just explain to me, what happens in the education room? What's the scenario?
So the education room, you can have like a school come to the wildlife center, and there'll be a wildlife person who would bring in a couple of the animals, maybe probably one at a time, and teach the class about the animals and about the wildlife in the area.
Cool.
So. Then this is the more like office space portion. These are offices down here, and an employee lounge, and the bathrooms and utility room. And then these are enclosures for education animals that might need more quiet. So they wouldn't want, you know, you might not want people coming by and looking at them all day long. They would just come out for the education. And then those stairs at the back go up to the rehabilitation center, which is located behind the community center to keep the privacy for the animals and, you know, keep the healing space separate from the activity of the community space. So all of these around here are animal enclosures. These are open air completely. And then these are a little more intense for things like bears, where you might not want just like a chain link fence keeping them in. So a little bit closer up. You can come in from here, but there'll be like a walkway. I haven't gotten to landscaping, but there'll be a walkway and a parking lot probably over here. And this area is actually, if something happens outside the normal hours of the Wildlife Center and someone needs to bring an animal in, they can call ahead and drop them here until someone can come and take care of it. Usually it's not that long, but a separate area so people don't have access to this whole section. So this side is more of the rehabilitation side, and this side is more of the veterinary side. So there's a nursery and ICU and the kitchen for making animal diets. Here's the employee lounge, and then this side has x-ray operating room, exam rooms for the vet staff. There's a rendering of some of the animal enclosures from the atrium. And then this room over here is the education room, the circular education room.
Yeah, so we're inside the center space
yes.
right now, and there's a big glass dome on top. Cool.
Yeah, and then actually behind us is a fountain,
mm-hmm.
and then the tall column that goes up that would have greenery on it.
Oh.
And the shelf, like right above,
mm-hmm.
will actually have greenery as well. So it'll be a pretty green space. And then this is a rendering of the community space and conference room. So those walls are retractable. You could have, you know, host parties at night or have local organizations come in, you could have a yoga class, anything like that.
In that window treatment, are those like little fins or something like that in the windows on the end to kind of do some shading?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
cool.
just because it kind of reminds me of trees, and like
yeah.
in a forest.
It kind of, it's reminiscent of what you did on the other side
yes.
surrounding the employee walkway too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Same kind of thing.
Cool.
And I think I put it outside some of the animal enclosures in the rehab portion as
mm-hmm.
well, just to kind of block the animals from the view of the people here.
Right.
So people wouldn't be intrigued by animals in the wildlife center and wander over there. Okay, so for the structure, the hardest part was the round portion of the building. Because it kind of had a different approach for each aspect of it. Once Glenn helped me with the circular concrete beam, it was a lot easier.
It sort of makes sense though, it's got a spiderweb effect. Yeah, you got a lot of different types of geometry going on there. But,
yeah,
because yeah.
this is the education room and the animal enclosures,
yeah.
and that's the community room. And the cafe is over here. I don't know. There is a like outdoor terrace on top. I think I have a 3D view there somewhere. Yeah, it's kind of close. So for lighting, I did this whole thing, and I knew there were a lot of windows. So I thought the lighting would probably be pretty intense for
yeah.
most of the building. And I ran it, and I got zero for everything. Zero passing
Uh-oh.
For everything. And then I realized that when I had designed it, in my brain, the south was to the right, but in Revit, the south was to the bottom. So like I had designed it,
yeah.
not really realizing it. So I rotated it for the second run. It was a lot better. It's not
okay.
great. It didn't include all the spaces, because apparently as I'd worked on it, some of the spaces have been deleted.
Okay.
So there's a lot of work that can be done, but at least it's not zero.
Yeah, no, it's in progress.
Yeah.
And you have a lot of very interesting indoor, outdoor, yeah.
Yeah, and some of the spaces, like the bathrooms and the utility rooms, don't need any light from the outside. Because they're not, I mean, I guess the bathrooms could use light, but you don't really need light in the utility room. Yeah, so here's an example, like here you can kind of see the mesh that's in the animal enclosures, that's open to the air, so I didn't want to condition these spaces because they're just literally keeping the outside. But I wanted the animals who are in here to not feel like they're in a box, and they can actually see outside and get some natural air and see the sky. So I ran energy analysis because I wanted to look at how the building was doing. And apparently there were a lot of features that it either didn't pick up on or that I hadn't included yet, like lighting, like artificial lighting. And I have an HVAC system, but it didn't pick up on it, so I don't know. The biggest concern that, well, the biggest energy usage here, it was saying, is, I think I have here. Yeah, the operating schedule was a big one.
Okay.
Because the rehab center operates for 12 hours, 7 days a week. And here, like, it could go down significantly if I decreased the amount of hours that people were there, but unfortunately, in a healthcare sort of situation, you can't just show up for 5 hours and leave.
Sure. So this is what you want to know with EUIs in general, is that, you know, if you have longer operating hours, of course you're going to need more energy per square foot. So don't feel bad about that. That's just the function of your building. We just have to compare you to other 12x7 buildings or 24x7 buildings.
Yeah.
That's,
yeah. So, I mean, I'm still looking into ways to maybe
yeah.
get that down by using more efficiencies or having more daylighting and those kinds of things, but
I think for a lot of people's buildings, you end up with one of the things is all like lighting power density or something like that. So like for yeah, anyone here, like if you just want to lower the lighting power density really quickly in a building, like how can you do that without really making a lot of changes? Like what affects yeah, energy?
You know of it?
Or yeah, or just you know, in general, like how would you approach lowering the lighting power density of a building?
More daylighting LEDs.
Yeah, it's things as simple as putting an LED bulb as opposed to incandescent and halogen and stuff like that. It's yeah, so even if the fixtures stay the same, but it's just a different type of bulbing system within there. And daylighting, occupancy sensors, all these different things. It's really weird how big an impact that stuff has because you spend all this time trying to optimize the windows and the wall surfaces, and then all of a sudden you find out that putting in more efficient light bulbs makes a bigger difference. So, But I guess that's because we tend to design pretty efficient buildings these days, so there's less room to improve in a lot of the envelope features, so it really does come down to a lot of operational stuff.
Yeah, I think in the community center, there's a lot of room for not powering portions of it that aren't in use at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Like during the day, there might be more people, but at night, if you don't have anyone in the community room, you can turn the lights off and power in there.
So Henry, you played with this a little bit. How can she go ahead and, even though her operating schedule says it's going, you know, 12 hours, to kind of adjust the occupancy, you know, during some of those hours so it's not penalizing you as though it's fully used those 12 hours?
For lighting or mechanical?
Well, it's for lighting and power. It's one of those, I think you played around with it quite a bit in terms of the operating schedules and adjusting the factors.
Oh, yeah. I just modified the occupancy schedule for some rooms.
In each of the spaces.
A little bit. Like for conference rooms, I made like, I knew they'd be spiky.
Mm-hmm.
And there's not a lot of people in them. There isn't anyone in them for most of the hours of the day, and then for a couple of hours there's suddenly a lot of people. Same thing with the food court, around lunch. And
yeah, and at certain peak periods where there's 100 people in there, then it's empty all afternoon.
And then for lighting, I just changed the watts per square foot to 0.4, 0.5.
That's a really easy way to do it. Yeah, just gotta change the space settings for the power density.
For I think that's a kind of conservative number for using LEDs. Because by default it's 1.2.
Yeah, which is pretty high. If you're using LEDs.
Yeah, cool. So a lot of things you can play with, but you just have a building that's used an awful lot of hours.
Yeah, so some challenges I had were figuring out the settings I would need to include for having mesh wall spaces and having the light go through them and to have air circulation through them. And then there were a lot of open air and unconditioned spaces, so I had to make sure that in my spaces settings that they were all listed as unconditioned, otherwise there'd be great inefficiencies. Any questions?
Thank you for sharing. Thank you for sharing a very different type of building. Cool.
Yeah.
I was curious for the rooms where you have animals inside.
Mm-hmm.
What did you imagine as the finishing on the interior of the walls?
Well, most of them are mesh or mesh and glass.
Okay.
And then you have like open to dirt, and you have like vegetation in there and little houses for them, depending on what it is. Like if you have squirrels, if you have possums, if you have, I wouldn't put deer in that portion of it. They'd probably be in the back portion with the rehabilitation building, but yeah, owls, you could put owls in there. Hawks.
Like a curtain wall.
Yeah, I put a curtain wall between the areas that visitors will be and the animals, because you know people like to put their fingers in and feed animals that they shouldn't be doing. So on the side where you have staff, I left it mesh, but on the side where there are visitors and animals, it's curtain walls.
Are there questions? Thank you very much for sharing that. Fantastic. Yay. Are you ready? Okay. We're going to finish up the dark room. It's the grand finale. No pressure, Henry. No pressure, Henry. Take cookies. Take brownies.
Okay, you got it?
Mm-hmm.
Super. Okay, why don't you bring it just on the PC side. Okay, and then you can close this and then open up yours. Where are we? Yay. Oh, actually, for all your final presentations, if you can, since they're all like PowerPoint presentations, like post them, what are we going to do? Oh, you put them on the A360 site. Somehow, I'll send something out about how to give them to it, because we want to put them in a collection somewhere where people can download them.
Mm-hmm.
They live onward for future generations.
So I need to admit that I didn't really put put some time on making this presentation, and these pictures are just like facilitating me to kind of tell you how the site is. So this is the real thing that is happening, not what I'm putting. So, and I really like this rendering, by the way.
Is that looking at the cows inside? Or can Henry go to have a question?
So can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
This is the real thing. I'm good.
is the tower vertical or is it slope?
Which one?
No, it's not the tower. The
this one? I see.
No.
Is it
not soaked.
Oh,
it's not soaked. I know that it looks like it's soaked.
It kind of looks like the cousin of the IFC. It looks very similar.
Yeah, it's like a cousin to it. And
okay.
It's like right next, like right across the harbor.
Is it the same architect?
I don't think so.
I don't know. We'll look that up. It looks like it's related, right?
Yeah, and the usage is really related as well. It's like office, hotel, and shopping malls.
So you have a very prominent site here in a very prominent world location.
Right, so the red area is the zone that I'm working on. And so this is the whole West Cullen Cultural District that they're trying to reclaim and develop. Actually, this is quite an open space there, nothing is really there. Only the like waterfront promenade and some open space, random open space. Sometimes for countdown, actually, the open space is for. And then so this is the art, some rendering that I tried to put up. This is not the best place to. So I just tried to walk me through my design. I think the first thing is this is not as sustainable as a building that you can think you can make, because I can't really put in much windows to it because I don't need to protect the paintings or any arts or sculpture that they're inside. So there's basically no windows except the curtain walls that people are entering. And then since for the same purpose, I have no like daylighting, so there would be like extremely amount of like lighting fixtures in it. So I'm trying to like separate the art and the people. So those curtain walls with daylight going in is like another separate zone that people can go through without like interfering the artworks. And so this oval shaped building is independent structurally, both structurally and like usage wise, with the like shape that like the U shape outside. And so this oval shape is a gift shop and a cafe with a restaurant in the second floor. And so for the architectural model, I think the hardest part is maybe to like work on with the oval shape, I'll say, especially with the stairs. But I'll say it's not as difficult as what Sunshine did.
Actually, just to give people a sense of scale, how big is that building like from side to side?
Oh, so it's actually like this way is 370 feet and this is like 450. So it's like a huge space. And everything that I'm thinking of, like especially for the mechanical systems, they're just like not in the scale that I think they will be. Mm-hmm. Especially I think if you kind of see how big it is when you come to the restroom like here, like there is like a ton of toilets that I can put in.
Exactly. There's a 1,000 people milling around here.
Yeah, so because like for this building, it's, I didn't really talk about it. It's like official arts museum. So my hope is to have like it as spatial as it can be. So people can like, so the density of the building is really low, I'll say it. So you can just imagine how spacious it is. And then it will be very quiet and you can just like, have your time with the arts.
There's a big atrium in the middle. People kind of move through the building that way. Then left and right side, there's some galleries as well as you have some
mm-hmm.
workspaces.
So I'm thinking there will be permanent galleries that themes will be permanent and they will have the associated gift shop with them. So you'll buy something related to that theme
as for some temporary galleries, which is, I'll say, it's like one by one ratio, that will, the theme will be like rotating, and then so it will be, there will be a backlog of like other things that you can rotate for the galleries. And so there are also three art studios that people or artists or like workshops can go on with the, yeah, so like it will interact with the customers that go in, and then you'll see how art's going on and you can work hands-on on it. And then so, yeah, and then there will be some show places for those art studios as well. So if you make something, you can like put it there and like let like share with others. And then for this one, this is actually an atrium. Okay, I'll say it to make it clear, this one, whole big thing is an atrium. Like, exactly, Oko shake.
Oh, do I have...
Yeah, okay, so this whole thing is an atrium, and then with the oval shape there as a separate building. And then the other side that I'm trying to tell you is another atrium that goes down to the basement, and it's like another shared place that I would like to like attract people going downstairs to the basement, and that would be a library in the basement as well.
Oh, so this is only where the light is coming through the atrium, since I was thinking that it's a separate area, separate zone, without the art, so I can have some skylights and bring in some daylight for the people.
And then it looks like you have skylights on the floor of the atrium too to bring light down to the basement level?
To the library, yes.
Fantastic.
Oops. So talking about HVAC, these are some separate HVAC zones that I put in to calculate the loadings. So you'll see that like the atrium whole thing is a zone. And then I separated it into like four different zones, like the southeast corner, like the southwest corner and stuff. And then so for the HVAC, I do have a very big problem that I was challenged, is that I only have one mechanical room per floor that I thought it would be enough because it's already per floor. But given the size, I think I'll need like four mechanical rooms like per floor at every corner. So for now, I only make the right side of it, and I have two air handling units already at the mechanical room, because if I cannot separate it into like two corners, like four mechanical rooms with separate air handling units, I'll need one with two. I'll take it back. It's like one with three. Like there's two air handling units supplying the whole right-hand side of the building, the galleries, and then one will will supply the air for the atrium. Oh, the right-hand side of the atrium, I'll say.
So let's just think about why that gets to be so bad. Galleries just as a use. It's kind of funny, even though you picture very few people in there, they get rated.
And they're
like, as though you're having a big cocktail party in there, there's a lot of people in there. So, you know, the capacity that's computed is just huge, which then ultimately leads to these giant ducts and just such a big airflow that, single air handlers just couldn't handle it. So
even like for this size, I actually have like 14 feet of level difference. And after I was trying to put in the HVAC system, I think that it will not be enough, so I change it to 15 feet per floor. And then I need to redo every like stairs or other things related to levels. And so for the HVAC system, I have chilled beams for every gallery, two beam sets for each gallery, to supply cold air, since the location is in Hong Kong, so like heating is really not a purpose, but cooling is. And so I think chilled beams will work best for the purpose. And then so I have the returns as the diffusers slots right by the walls under the ceilings. And then I think the chilled beams will be right at the ceiling, same level as the ceiling tiles. And then, so I also have the diffusers facing the atrium side to be at between like level one and two, like by the ceiling level, such that it will be like right at the top of a person, and then it's not too high to supply pressure for them.
So these whole two-story atriums get to be really kind of tricky to introduce air into, because You have this huge volume of space above your head, but it's getting hot, but there's no one there. So it's a real kind of interesting issue about where the best to introduce the cool air.
So the cool air supply will be between the first floor and the second floor, and then when we talk, when I talk with Glenn, the return will be like by the trusses, and it will hang the like warmed air, used air to the air handling units.
So just to say that, yeah, you get a feeling for the problem. Next time you're walking through the airport or something like that, you're in a big concourse. Yeah, just start trying to figure out where the air is coming in, where all the air handling is happening. It's really quite tricky in those spaces that are 30 feet tall above your head with all those people in there. But yeah, you don't want to have a lot of air terminals everywhere where people are tripping over. Mm-hmm. So it's quite a trick to see how that air mixes in there.
Yeah, we're hoping that there will be convection going in. And then so the atrium will work out. And then so this is a cross section to how I will introduce fresh air and how I will like pull away the exhaust air. It will be extracted through the roof. And since these are two floors for the basements, it will be in entirely another system, which I didn't put in. So just need that. And so that exhaust is like a huge exhaust propeller. It's because it will propel four air handling units of air for both of the floors. I would just connect, because there are two air handling units per floor, I just connect them together. So I'll need a huge one. Although the return air actually is like a return air to the same air handling unit, some of it, and so it will go to will have some like fresh air supply to it. But still, I'll need a huge exhaust air propeller. And then, so for the plumbing system, I don't have a stack. Oh, I'll say I worked on the stacked restrooms, and I just neglect the another like non-stacked one. But I have think about the strategy for the other restroom. That I'll just keep it simple, so I do the stacked one. And then, so for this restrooms, they're all stacked together to like. Throughout four levels, and then you'll see how big the building is, because there's like just like I remember like 16 like toilets per restroom, only for like female, and then so it's not as hard as it tracks to connect them together. But the only thing that I encounter is how to put the water from the faucets. To get going, because there's just no alternate routes for them. I have no idea why. And then so for now, the sanitary is like above. I was planning to have it connect with toilets since they're back-to-back at one of the sides. But I think it's too high of the elevation, so I just bring it down
right at the back of the walls.
That's kind of hard. Actually, can you go back a little? Just did the last slide of the picture of the restroom there. I hadn't thought about it really until just right now. One thing you may want to think about architecturally is when you have a restroom that large with so many sewers and stuff like that, you might actually even get into having two different doors coming into it, or sort of an in and out, so that you don't have, one door or something like that. A lot of actually think like that. Airports. This reminds me of an airport. Somehow the scale and the number of people trying to move that many people. It's just interesting because
don't realize there are retail cars.
It could be. It's just one of those things to think about.
Yeah. Again, kind of anticipating the lines already.
Yes.
So two doors may be good. And then so since they're stacked, it's easy to copy them, and I'm happy with that, so I just copy them together. The only thing is I just need to connect them to the shafts that I will get for them to go straight down to the level 2, which I'll handle all of these plumbings.
Actually, as long as you're copying and stacking, can mechanical rooms be copied and stacked?
Can what? I'm sorry?
The mechanical rooms, if you have air handlers and it's heating off to...
Actually, for the other, for the HVAC system, it looks like I did copied it through, like, level 1 to 2, but I didn't because
it's just a pretty different system, and it will be having different sizing of pipes, so I do all the connections again.
Okay. So in your building at CV, in a lot of office buildings, if you're doing a 10-story office building or something like that, they probably just lay out one floor, they bring it back to the core, and then they copy and paste it up, same way you do the restrooms. So
that would be really nice.
Yeah, there's always efficiencies, there's reasons buildings look that way, just because it gets to be very easy.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Ask
Kevin. Yes.
Oh, no, I'm just, I'll talk about it later.
Okay. Sounds good.
Yeah, so I think the only thing that I didn't talk about is structure system. That's because it's a pretty regular shape, as you see. So I pull the beams and trusses through regular grids. So I don't think there's any different, like, more inspiration for you guys than that.
No worries.
Yeah. So it's,
yeah. Sounds good. Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing. This is such a monumental building. It's not quite about the scope of it. Because it's, you know, it's like your building is monumental and it's these 43 pavilions are all actually, yeah. This thing is just huge. And I don't think Abe and I really realized how big it was when we first started going with it. We started really going into, wow.
Yeah, so only the scaling issue has changed. It's not really how
I think we all sort of did that. It's just sort of like, as things get to be that big, everything, ducts get big, pipes get big. So that's when you almost have to think about, it's one big building, but can you think of it as four zones? Even though they're physically connected, yeah, that all kind of come together. Henry, go ahead and pop it in this one.
Oh, no, this one.
That's the HDMI.
Oh, yeah.
There you go. Okay, and finishing us off today, we have...
Guys, there's one more.
Yeah. You have our rapt attention. Or our sugar cookie hot. One or the other. Hey, the webinar looks like Stanford.
No, it's just the... No, I left this because... the building I designed is... The architecture is also like stone, so
it's reminiscent? You found design inspiration in our own local buildings?
Partly that, partly I'll explain why.
Okay.
Do you know how to...
I'm
not very familiar with the Mac. Oh, slideshow.
Oh, just slideshow.
From the beginning. Oh, great. Okay, good.
Back to comfort. Okay. No, there's no Mac in front of you. Just push the
button. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm a lead sustainability engineer with HH Enterprises, and I want to tell you guys about my design. I designed this sustainable community center for an owner in Lebanon. So I'll walk you through my thought process, and I'd be really interested in some feedback and sharing some of my design decisions. So I'm an engineer by training, so I don't have a lot of extravagant architecture going on, but more of like an engineer's thought process. So first I'm gonna fill you in on, I'll give you some project background, then talk about my design rationale, what went into my design. And then I left maybe quick few minutes for what I wanna do between now and the next submission. What you see today is mostly like in schematic design, and then we'll finish the design sometime this week. So some project background: the owners are just a local municipality in the area, in the town. It's in Lebanon. Just to give you some perspective, just because like it's a very small country. So this is the world: Africa, Europe. So it's on the Mediterranean Sea. If we zoom in. We'll zoom in some more, and it's like 20 miles from the coast at about 3,000 feet of elevation, and this is the site the owner can use, and the zoning requirements, you're allowed to build about 30% of the size of the lot, and about three or four floors, so. The whole idea behind the project was a couple of things. the owner really wants to promote sustainability within the community and the country. So this is kind of like a leading example project for other future buildings and to educate the community, younger children, and other engineers. So this building will serve as like, so one, we can teach young students about like sustainability practices and bring in young kids on summer camps to you know, play with Legos and Kleenex and some civil engineering activities. And also as a hub for civil environmental engineers. So you can hold conferences there. There's an exhibition center and some private offices. So this is kind of like the list I kept going back to when trying to looking at the owner's specifications and requirements. These are kind of like my targets and to satisfy the client's requirements. So the first step was architectural fit. That's the end of project background. So for architectural fit, most of the buildings in Lebanon are kind of like what you saw in Stanford, or kind of like an old Roman architecture. It's like a lot of limestone and like those red shingles for the roof. So this is kind of what it looks like. The west side of the house faces the Mediterranean,
Can you see the sea from your side?
Fantastic.
That's quite a view.
Because of the landscaping of the country,
yeah.
There's a lot of houses like this, because
it's very wrong view.
A huge trade-off I faced was, you have the beach views, but then you want to orient the long side on towards the west, and it's kind of like a trade-off between views and
No one wants the office with a back
view. That was a challenge. But I oriented the long sides north south, but I put the entire west as glass. I don't know if you guys have any other suggestions. I'm open for it. So architecture fit, I just made I have to match the three or four stories with this kind of stone finish. That's my architectural design. So this is kind of an example. So yeah, like a lot of houses have views out to the beach. So you have these lot of limestone, red bricks, red shingles. So this is a zoomed in version. So that's kind of the architecture I was going for.
Interesting, that rough cut stone in the red tile. Okay.
Yeah. So you can see it's a little bit similar. That's my first requirement, architecture fit.
Okay.
And second was giving back to the community. So these are some of the things I just mentioned earlier. So we have kid zones for young children to engage in civil activities, like some sort of nerd summer camp thingy, an exhibition area, and there's furnished offices for practicing civil engineers and sustainability enthusiasts, and some conference rooms for visiting professionals.
Where do we sign up?
That's the intent. It's free to the public.
Fantastic.
Revenues might come from just selling food in cafeteria and gift shops and stuff like that.
I think it's a very noble mission to think about how you get kids involved and get them excited about sustainability and building, and then they'll carry it to the next generation. That's really, you start young with Legos and Kleenex.
Yeah, it's all in the training, I think. Those are the features I considered when doing my floor plan layout.
Sure.
I want to make sure this building works well with the environment, so it doesn't go against it, but it's working with it. So the first thing I considered in working with the environment was orientation. So as I mentioned, it was a little challenging because. So the west side, there's the beach, and you end up with better energy efficiency figures. Long side's facing north, oriented north south. So that's what I went with, but I mean, I don't know, we'll see what the owner says.
It's always a trade-off.
Yeah, so that's the building footprint. So it's kind of like a basic rectangle. And for the floor plan layout, my intent was I separated those, so the features I talked about, the kid zones and the offices and the conference rooms, I separated them into private and public. So private, I put on the top floor, and the public areas are, I thought would make sense on the ground floor, just as like architecturally. So the public would be like education rooms where like young teenagers, high school students, and young college students can come take sustainability classes. Kid zones for your people in 10 years old, 12 years old. Exhibition area and privates for the older professionals. So we're trying, the idea is we're trying to target a lot of different age segments. So yeah, private on the top floor and public on the ground floor. So more about the floor plan layout. Did some wind analysis, and most of the wind's coming from the west. And the whole idea behind the design was I separated also another binary approach was I did the there are rooms that are classified as more passive and rooms that are classified as more, they're like spiky loads and they're not occupied the whole day, but when they're occupied, they're being occupied by a lot of people. An example of that is the like education rooms and maybe the food court, where like during lunch hours there's a lot of people eating. Education rooms is, you don't have classes in there all day, but when there's a class, there's a lot of people in there. So I tried to put the more passive areas towards the west, or like along the north-south, but more towards this area, and this area is more more like. This is like this uses more like HVAC, and this is more passive.
Okay.
So I can use the predominantly that's mostly have like cooling loads of problem. So yeah. I thought I'd use wind for cooling and the passive areas, So I'll keep going.
Your distinction's good. I'd call it steady state versus spiky. It's like
So study room is not too occupied. I put it also in the passive area. The conference rooms are spiky, I put them towards the top. And the offices are they're not spiky. And I put some here and some here. These are just extras. So I put the lobby where the road wide might be. That's in the entrance. And so here's what I was talking about. That's where the beach area is. So in places where I imagine more people seating for longer periods of time. I put those areas overlooking the view. And then the lobby and gift shop are by the street. And gift shop is, I think it makes sense, you know, it's like impulse buying. So it might be a good idea. The green highlights the more of the passive zones. We have a couple of people walking in and out and looking at things, but not, people aren't sitting in there all day. And it's like not a huge load, but just constant and average. And then the black is the more of the spiky areas. So, even though most of the spiky areas should be here, this one, because you're sitting, I thought it'd be nice to look at the views. Education rooms are spiky, restrooms are. So by spiky also, these are like restrooms that I need to take care of the smell, and so it needs an HVAC system. The idea is the green area is mostly predominantly cooled by a radiant floor, and then the black areas need an HVAC system for the spiky areas. Food court needs HVAC because you're cooking and you want smell. And a similar approach for the top floor. These are past, like not spiky. The offices have, you know, one or two people. These are private engineering offices. You might have one guest, you know, not spiky. And then those are the black or HVAC cooled conference rooms and restrooms for smell. And, And there I have a skylight, yellow skylight.
Another thing that sort of works about your layout is, you think about where the street is and people coming in from the lobby. Most of your heavy used rooms are kind of close to the lobby here, the stairs, the elevator, whatever you have going on over there, so that you can get to them without having to go through the exhibit spaces. So,
yeah.
Yeah, you get to, yeah, without, so it's easy to sort of control the access a little bit. Yeah, you don't have to go through a lot of other spaces to get to that. So a lot of things about your layout just sort of make sense.
Okay. Oh, good. You're talking about from a mechanical standpoint?
Well, mechanically, I think you've got it there. I'm just thinking about it even just architecturally, just programming the space. If people are coming in to use the conference room or the education spaces, and it's in the evening, I can sort of say, oh, you come in up to a certain part, but you don't go past this door. So you don't need to actually go back into the exhibit space.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, you've zoned it mechanically, but I think it actually, you know, there's sort of a functional reason why it works that way to zone it too.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I mean, the whole motive for this passive inspire was I want to do a radiant floor, which is, and then only use HVAC for a little bit. So it was mostly cooled by the radiant floor, and if that's not enough, then you turn on the HVAC. Similar to this
sort of
design.
Steady state versus surge.
Yeah.
There's another way to say that.
And one of the targets for another was also minimizing the energy usage because, cost of electricity there is like double here. It's around $0.2 per kilowatt hour. So it's a big motivation. So here, most of the load was cooling from electricity, and we have a little bit of window solar and plug load equipment, mostly loads. So what I did was I noticed there's a big amount for window solar and a small for window conductive. So insulation wasn't a big emphasis because the conduction is small through the window. So I focused on choosing a lower solar heat gain coefficient window. Then my EUIs came out, I would say, relatively low, but which is good. 23 kilowatt per square foot per year. This building is operated till around 9 p.m.
That strikes me as being very low, right?
For like downstairs, and then upstairs are till 5 because it's just private offices upstairs. This whole layout was for just get a really good heating and cooling thing going. Again, black is like where I have ducts, where I need HVAC, and then in the green areas, I use the combination of radiant floors and fans, so there isn't need for ducting, and all of these have. Windows, I think it's required if you don't have by type 24, if you don't have ducts, if you don't have mechanical ventilation, you need at least the window area has to be like at least 5% of the square footage of the room. There's a lot of windows here from up to the beach. That's okay. And the green is the exhaust from the restrooms and from the food court. Take out the cement, and here's the MEP room. The pink is the return, and blue is the supply. So I'm supplying to the conference rooms, and to the food court and to the bathrooms. I'm only exhausting from the food court and the bathrooms. I'm not returning to the bathrooms and to the food court because I don't want to return this smell.
You're
correct. Yeah.
You would take that out as waste exhaust here.
Similarly for the upper floor, here I have a void, I have like an atrium thing going, and it's a same concept. These aren't high loads, they have fans. Plus a cooled radiant floor. This is the radiant floor on this is level 2.
So in this case, you're running it throughout the entire floor as opposed to like office box. So here it's going to cool the entire floor as opposed to thermostats in individual offices.
I thought the thermostat would be turning on and off the fan.
Oh, very good. So you'll handle individually that way. So this
is that a bad setup? Or
no, that's fine. It's really, I think since you're going for just sort of this kind of steady state, is what this kind of general level of cool. You always handle your surge in these rooms more with the fans or opening a window for natural ventilation, something like that. That's good. Yeah, it's just really, everyone, it's different approaches, and I think this actually, given your strategy, worked pretty well. Just sort of do it for the entire building.
I'm unaware if you can thermostatically adjust the cooling or heating from the water pipes.
What happened is you'd run pipes from an individual room back individually to a valve manifold and then just kind of turn on and off the water to kind of increase or decrease the amount of chilling happening in that
room. Okay. Would that mean any mechanical room?
Yes.
Or
typically there's a valve manifold. Yeah, it's typically like in some sort of room where pumps are, mechanical equipment and stuff like that.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's probably a more, gives more control. So
yeah, a little more control. Yeah.
I like this building. On the south, the offices are deeper and narrower, while on the north, because you get more light. So on the north, I made them a little wider, shallower. So a lot of thought in the floor plan layout. But yeah, so this is like some of my, this is a 3D version of the HVAC system. And I'm showing a combination of, so this, here you have in the black areas you have the HVAC, and then in the green areas you have the fans. Even though I don't think anyone cares about looking at the mechanical room, just in terms of like an owner or, but to me it was a lot of work just aligning the pipe, the ducts. So I felt happy in doing it. Just rendering it. But, yeah.
There's a sense of satisfaction when it all comes together neatly.
Yeah, there's one here and there's one here above the ceiling. And that's the door. And I think one here. That's the structure. Mm-hmm. I didn't go too deep into. I chose concrete for thermal mass for a few reasons. One, because it's that's what people know how to build there, and the nice thing is that we're around 3,000 feet, so during the day it's kind of warm. This is an example in like July. It's around there's like you get like an almost like a 20 degree drop in Fahrenheit, so the thermal mass is good for that. So you can, you warm it up during the day and you can use that heat a little bit at night. So it's like a battery. And then some other things to like reduce energy consumption. I put like so these curtain walls are shaded from like the slab on top. I was trying to give it a little less boxy look also. I had issues with the beach versus energy efficiency trade-off. I put overhangs on the north and south and fins on the east and west. I'm going to be completely honest, I assume that's a good solution, but in terms of energy analysis, my analysis numbers weren't changing, but I had issues with like modeling. I had issues quantifying the energy savings from applying fins. My numbers wouldn't change. I'm not sure. Modeling. Yeah. Anyway. You size your fin. You size your overhang so that you can still bring in sunlight in winter, but you won't.
That's it. We're looking at the south side, and that's like around 11 o'clock in the morning or something.
This is the south. This is the west.
So the individual fins on the windows. Something there. That's good. haven't yet, but like just looking at your building, I think one thing that would be kind of fun to explore architecturally, and I know you're looking at very much from the mechanical side, would be even taking that roof and giving like broader overhangs on it or something like that. I think if they just came out like even 3 or 4 feet more or something like that, it might just give just a little more definition to it. Because this kind of very horizontal planes, that's okay, that's good architectural style. It's just, it almost wants to just be even stronger in the horizontal to really say that's what you're up to or something. Or as you look at it, what can we do in terms of, because you can get some red tile on there in terms of the little cupola on the top and around the steps, something like that. But yeah, the stone, I get that, that's a native material.
To be honest, I'd rather the sloped roof.
Yes.
But it was easier to model.
Oh, no worries. Yeah. So we can slope the roof up there a little bit. Somehow I want you a little bit overhang or something like that. It's something because that's such a nice, big, strong base. It just feels like you can carry a bigger roof. I don't know, but that's all your infinite time between now and some other time.
Yeah, I also need training and like doing the renderings. I think the background image never aligns properly with my.
Actually pretty amazing that you have these background images. That's plausible. It's not quite believable yet. Somehow, Sanchai, if you guys got together, like he could show you some tricks about like how to. Yeah. It's all this funny thing about you have to find something that's at the right perspective for where the camera would be.
For the columns, I put like some limestone finishing, and then on the curtain walls, like, because you have the structural beams showing, so for one of the panels, I don't know if you guys can see, I put like a wood finishing, right here.
Yeah.
One thing I'd like to work on is, I want to break some of the stone. I think there's too much stone. I want to break it with some other materials, like more wood or more glass or more something else. This is another side. That's the north and east.
We need to get together with some of the architects. Like Brittany could help you with this too, in terms of if we're thinking about that those windows somehow tying into a band with another material. It's gonna be something that'll just give it a little more definition. Yeah, but again, you're very close. It's just there's little things you do that sort of just make it really just become much more interesting really quickly. Yeah, you're in good shape.
Next, for daylighting, I had things going well, and then when I generated daylighting like a couple of days ago, it was fine, but then when I finished doing my mechanical systems, I added this thing on top.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if it's because of this thing, there's a skylight here. I am getting no light in the middle.
Oh, really? We've been hitting this in 120C too. There's something about the daylighting server that just seems really warped, especially the last. I have no idea what's going on, but it shouldn't have made that big a difference. Well, especially like not at 3 o'clock in the afternoon or something. That's kind of around the 9 o'clock side.
This wasn't there before, and then because I had pipes coming up, so I can connect it to an air handler unit and hide the air handler unit.
Yeah.
Not the air handler unit. Yeah, the air handler unit. So I'm getting no light down the middle, but I'm gonna have to fix that for next week.
There's something else going on. That's weird. I don't know. So it's
For this area, I was hoping to put some. I have like a grass area. I was hoping to put like a walk path that's like also a skylight.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah. Glass tiles that are in the ceiling. Then.
Yeah. Yeah, here's my issue with this thing.
Nice.
I put a sky in the middle, I used LEDs, and I tried to make it somewhat rectangular so I can get daylighting inside everywhere, plus the skylight for the middle.
Yeah, the size and dimension around the atrium, that should be pretty good. You should be able to get the sky light in there. Something about the models blocking it,
which
should be.
That's my entire design. And then future work, I didn't model any of the plumbing for the bathrooms yet. Mostly because.
You better, I hear the snowing.
The it wasn't a huge impact on my design because like I didn't feel like it was affecting energy performance and just really focusing on.
I'm just laughing because your ventilation, you're quite adamant about ventilation.
Yeah. This is what I wanted to learn most about. I'm gonna add an actual the actual geography from the Google Maps I showed. PV is a really good potential. There's a lot of sunlight there. And I'm gonna add some furniture and like finishing material for like the interior walls and slab. And then the enclosure is what I talked about earlier about breaking some of the stone with some other materials.
Sure. Kind of to continue to add a little architectural interest and design to it. Because clearly, even the way you presented it, you thought very carefully about the mechanical system hierarchy and how to organize the space to do all that. Yeah, now you just need to collaborate with someone who thinks about it more from a strictly design side, and you're going to find that happy medium in there. This is kind of, we all come at it from different perspectives. Some of us are mechanical designers, some come at it very structurally, some come at it very architecturally, and it's really, that's where working as a team is really important. You can sort of get that balance and you find creative solutions around that stuff. So, and you're well on your way. It's just a matter of, and you know where you continue to focus the energy. So, I think you're in great shape.
Thank you.
Questions for Dr. Hermanoffi?
I just thought it was neat that he's using the fans because that could be very efficient. And it's very user based. Like you said, if you're too hot, then you turn on the fan.
Yeah.
It's very simple and straightforward.
There's something beautifying about that in terms of systems that people do control, because then you sort of feel like you're a part of the solution. When you're hot, you sort of do something about it, as opposed to in big black boxes, you sort of assume, oh, I'm hot, there's nothing I can do about it, therefore you just sort of live with it, and you don't feel very disconnected. So I kind of like buildings where you can open your own windows, or you can turn on your own fans, because I think it just makes you aware of your role in being part of the system. So that's pretty good. Actually, I'm trying to think of different parts of the world, fans are the predominant cooling source in a lot of places. Aircon is just not a very economical way to go and stuff like that. We've got to do too many buildings where they're only air conditioned, but I think I'd like to see more buildings that, even for you, since you have this relatively good climate, more windows that can open broadly and just really let some of the favorable days, just more natural ventilation and kind of the outside to come inside.
I mean, it was hard to quantify since this is a mixed with the air and the radiant floor. It's hard to model and rivet.
Yeah.
Because it's unless you do your own separate calculations for the radiant floor and to offset with the air, because when rivet calculates HVAC loads, it's assuming.
It presumes a big air system.
So that's a challenge. And I think that's it.
Yeah, I think you sort of hit some funny challenges in that. Just having all the unconditioned or open air spaces is just a little, it's weird how you model that around it. And you're not quite sure if it's doing the right things. Sort of physically, and this is, I think, one of the limitations of the modeling now that eventually it'll kind of kick out. When it makes an energy model, it sort of makes it as a steady state. It doesn't really handle the fact that windows are operable and somehow treat that as a separate surface that could be considered open or closed. It just sort of is a single item. And, I think as you think about how energy modeling can improve, as we use it more, we're going to start getting more demanding of how come it doesn't model that accurately, and we'll start seeing tools that do a better job of that, because if you can presume that those windows are going to change their properties 20% of the time, or whatever it is, then the model should really be a factor, weighted average of two different states.
Yeah.
you're on sort of a really interesting issue in general about modeling tools where, you know, the things that are easy to model, you know, become the things that have become very common because they are easy to model, so it encourages those sorts of things. So even if you look at, you know, what Revit is really good at, you know, a lot of the architectural tools, it's good for big rectangular buildings that are air conditioned. And then when you start trying to break that mold, you know, you run into these different challenges. And it is kind of weird, because I think just as people who think about tools and how it influences your design, it does have an impact. Yeah, I think you're right. If we had better ways to model that and we could actually see the impacts of our modeling changes, we'd be more encouraged to experiment with that. Or even like, you know, you're trying to play around with the shades and you're trying to make a difference, and no matter what you do, you can't get that number to move. And that's, you know, which after a while you give up on it. Okay.
Yeah, I've added between like 0 and 10 feet horizontal, vertical, different materials. I don't know, maybe there's a setting I missed. I'm not sure.
Exactly.
If
you're
starting,
yeah, so I think that's really an overall criticism or a challenge we're all facing, is that at some level, the tools promise to be very powerful, but they're a little bit too black box, so that you're not really sure if the changes you're making are reflected, or the settings are hidden in so many different places, you're not sure if you made all the changes you need to make that. And, you know, that just, if that gets better, it'll encourage us to be more creative designs, because, it's really funny. It's human behavior. If you don't get rewarded for the behavior, you're not going to do it. So if there's no reward for modeling in detail, then okay, why put in fans? It can't simulate them anyway. But it should. Ceiling fans are perfectly valid way, and how that factors into your natural ventilation strategy, and that should be rewarded. I guess that's something we all have to work on. No limitation of the technology. This is supposed to inspire you to, you're going to go out, Henry, and write the plug-in that's going to do it right. You know, supplement the functionality, because all this stuff is changeable. You know, it's programmed by a small number of people who are writing tools like this and stuff like that. So if you understand it better, there's a lot of room to improve the tools. I refuse to give up. I want better tools. Thank you, Dr. Harmanji.
Thank you.
And thank you all for sharing your designs, which are inspired in so many different ways. I'm pleased with this whole notion of people taking it in very different directions, because we saw a lot of different, really interesting, cool ideas that make you think very differently, as opposed to just doing the one program over and over again. So I like that aspect. This is the first time I've tried it. And in fact, you know, the person to whom we have to thank for even giving me to consider that is sitting right here in the front row, because he actually proposed doing that. And I thought it was a really great idea. So thank you, Gustavo, for even sort of suggesting that it would be quite a cool idea. Because I think we should definitely just keep on going with the design room. Okay. Thank you. Yes.
My pleasure.
Glad you could join us for the whole experience. We'll be around tomorrow and through, just helping you finish things up. So go ahead and continue with some things, get to a reasonable stopping point, and just, you know, call it quits and put a bow on it and post your final design journal entry. There's always going to be more to do that you're not going to get to, and that's kind of okay. Yeah, you should, you know, rather be proud of everything you have accomplished and not worry about those 3 things that you never got to work and sort of stay up night working, it's not worth it. You know, just because it's amazing how much you've accomplished. So take great pride in that. Okay, let us adjourn for today.